Hello, friends. I'm Dennis Calhoun, the senior minister of the Old North Church in Marblehead, Massachusetts. We are an open and affirming congregation of the United Church of Christ, and I'm delighted to welcome you to our worship service on this fifth Sunday in Eastertide, and to wish a happy Mother's Day to the mothers among us. We're gathered from our scattered homes and our varied lives, and it is good, so very good, that we can be together in this way at this time. I encourage you to find the Show More button on your computer screen. You can click there to find the order of worship for this service. And thanks to everyone who had a part in creating this virtual worship experience. And thanks to you for joining us wherever you are. Now let's take a moment to settle and center ourselves as we open our hearts and minds to worship in spirit and in truth.
Hi, people of God, people of Old North Church. I'm the Reverend Lindsay Popperson, your associate pastor. Settle yourself down now, or find something to keep your hands busy. Pour yourself a cup of coffee. Set aside this hour as a time of sacred pause, a moment of connection. Let us call ourselves and one another into worship. We are God's household, built by the one who birthed creation. Our hearts a shelter for the outcast, our hands open to the stranger. We are God's people, created in the divine image to tell others of God's love, to offer mercy as freely as we have received it. We are God's children, called to give of ourselves, chosen to serve the lost and the lonely, gifted to minister to a hurting world. Here, sheltered under God's wings, let us worship the God who is love.
Thank you.
Shall we pray? Mothering God, whose nurturing love brought us to life, draw us near to you. You've promised to never leave us orphaned. Come to us now. We have gathered in the hope of worshiping you in spirit and in truth. Come into the smallness of our minds with your divine greatness. Break through the boundaries of our understandings of your love, your will, your ways, that we may know you when you appear along our path through life. Help us to recognize Christ as he meets us where we are. Now settle and center us in the name and spirit of the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. It's easy for us to boast of our achievements, but hard to come humbly before God with the mistakes we make. Now, in the blessed quietness, we are called to present our whole lives to the one who means to shape us into new people. Let us offer our prayers of confession in silence. Amen. Friends, believe the good news. The Holy One who calls us here is able and willing to make all things new. Through the grace of Christ, the love of God, and the power of the Holy Spirit, we are a new creation. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Hello, my name is Karen Kilty, and it is my pleasure to serve as the Director of Children's Ministries at Old North Church. This is the time in our service where we invite our children to come forward. So today, children, while you're in your home and I am in mine, once again, I invite you to lean in just a little closer. I was looking through a drawer the other day and came across some of my favorite things. I hadn't seen them in a while. It was back of a corner of a drawer I don't use very often, but it made me smile. Brought back memories of things that I had done, things that I had used in years past. I know you have some favorite things too. And as I've gotten to know you, you've shared some of those things that you really love, things that make you happy, and you didn't even have to say that you loved them. I could tell that it was love. I could feel it. I think of you, Graham, when you talk about your passion for the Cubs, love. And Patrick, when you tell me about time spent with your cousins. And Piper, when you share your art pieces with me and you talk about how much you enjoy creating them. Connor and Noah, I think of the yards and yards and maybe even miles of finger knitting you've done and how you've shared how you can wrap them around your dad's house. You always have a big smile when you share that. Sarah, I love to see your face when you talk about your dancing and your family. And Callum, oh, I always think it's so fun to hear your update on how many times you've been able to kick that soccer ball, keeping it off the ground with great skill. The last I heard, it was over 4,000. I think of those of you who have pets and feel that love for them when you talk about them. Such sweet thoughts and words as you talk about Ginger and Wrigley and Ollie and Fenway, Harley, Elsa, Cooper, Hannah, Pope Joan, and Wendell too. You show your love for them when you talk about them and tell the stories about them. And I can tell by your voice, the way your body moves, and when you share those favorites of your favorites, I know it is love. And the best part is when I see that special expression on your face, that happy smile, the happy face. In today's reading, we will hear Jesus say, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments." Jesus says that it's not enough just to say, "God, I love you." It is in our actions that Jesus calls us to show God our love. Jesus' commandment is simple: love one another. When we are able to love one another, we are sharing our love for God. You may remember these words that we have heard in our classroom. Jesus says, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you." And just as we have different favorite things, we all have different ways of loving God and showing God of that love. The more we open our hearts to God's love for us, we will grow in our love for God and others. Just like how you feel about your favorite things, we will be able to see your love for God in the way you move, in the way you share the stories, the way you reach out and care for one another. And as you grow, you will find other ways to show your love for God, and we will see it in your happy faces. Will you pray with me? Holy One, abundant love, we tell you we love you, but we know that we need to show you our love too. Please watch over us this week and help us to make loving choices and see you along the way. Amen.
I have a dream I hope will come true, that you're here with me and I'm here with you.
I wish that the earth, sea, the sky above will send me someone to love.
Turned out better, I think.
Good morning. I'm Diane Thomas, a deacon at Old North Church. The first scripture reading this morning is from the book of Acts, chapter 17, verses 22 through 27, Paul's journey to Athens. Paul then stood up in a meeting of the Areopagus and said, "People of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' So you are ignorant of the very thing you worship, and this is what I'm going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by human hands. And he's not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. From one man he made all the nations, that they should inhabit the whole earth, and he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their lands. God did this so they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he's not very far from any one of us. You've heard this reading from Scripture. Let us find within the meaning of God.
Our second gospel reading this morning is from the 14th chapter of John, verses 15 through 21. If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will know that I am in the Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me. And those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them. We have heard these words from the Scriptures. Let us find in them the Word of God.
Please, will you pray with me? God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts gathered together be acceptable to you, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Beloved, I want you to take a nice, deep breath. In through your nose, out through your mouth. Fill up your lungs as full as you can, and then let that air back out into the world. I've been thinking about my lungs so much more these days. Most of you know that I've recovered from the coronavirus. I'm feeling 100% now, and I am noticing my lungs. I was lucky I never had much difficulty breathing when I was sick, but that didn't stop me from anxiously Googling every symptom of pneumonia over and over and over again. I started holding my breath, counting how long I could last, checking my lung capacity. Every single breath feels precious right now, especially as I'm conscious that there are so many struggling to breathe in these days. You have heard me say that the word for spirit and wind and breath are all the same words in the biblical language. Ruach in Hebrew and pneuma in Greek. Pneuma, that's the same word that's the root of pneumonia, breath, wind, spirit. Our gospel reading for today comes from Jesus' long goodbye to his disciples. It was his last night, the night he was betrayed, and they had sat together at the table, and he had blessed bread and broke it and gave it to them. He had poured out the wine and told them that it was the cup of the new covenant in his blood. He had wrapped a towel around his waist and knelt down to wash their feet, showing that he would act as a servant to them, and calling them to act as servants to one another and to all the hurting world. Then he gave them some instructions on how to live faithfully in the difficult days ahead. They had no idea what was coming to them. He had been warning them over and over that the way he lived would get them killed. But they didn't want to believe it. They were about to be living through a wild trauma for which they were utterly unprepared. They were about to be separated from their Lord and teacher by death and by an unjust empire. They were about to see him hanging on a cross, struggling to breathe. They were about to have the rug pulled out from under them. They were about to be thrown into the chaos of grief. And here is what Jesus says to them. I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him because he abides with you and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. Jesus knows that days of grief and disorientation are coming for the disciples. Jesus knows that these ones who have spent 3 years following him as he preached and healed and sat at tables, that soon they will have no idea what to do. To them, Jesus promises that he will send an advocate, a comforter, a Spirit of truth. In Greek, pneuma aletheia. Pneuma aletheia. That Spirit will abide in us, will literally make its home in us. I find this story of Jesus reassuring his disciples to be so tender. They don't know what's coming, but Jesus does, and he knows what they'll need to survive the trauma and the grief and the disorientation. He knows what they'll need to rebuild their lives and to care for their communities. He promises them that while he is leaving, he will not leave them orphaned. He will send the Spirit of truth, the pneuma aletheia, to dwell with them as close as their own breath. What the disciples needed 2,000 years ago is not so different from what we need now. They needed each other. They needed to connect, to worship, to pray, to share their burdens and their joys. They needed reassurance that they were not alone and would never be left alone. They needed the very presence of God. And they would need to learn to find God in a different way than they had before. While they had known Jesus in flesh and blood, riding in the dirt and rowing in a boat and placing his hands upon the sick, now they would find God through the Holy Spirit, as close to them as their own breath. They would search for God and perhaps grope for God and find God, though indeed God is not far any one of us. In these strange, hard days, I would like to commend a spiritual practice to you. Breathing. I imagine you've tried breathing before once or twice or maybe billions of times. You've probably taken about 100 breaths or 200 since I started preaching, about 23,000 breaths since this time yesterday, and about 300 million breaths since you were born, give or take a few million if you're as old as I am. Whether you noticed those breaths or you didn't, you were breathing in and out. And whether you noticed God or you didn't, God was as close to you as your own breath. Every day, every minute, every second of your life, people of God, God is as close to you as your own breath. That's true for the babies who are being born even now, even during a pandemic, who take their first deep breaths and just wail, just scream out into the world. It's true for the people at the nursing home where I work, people who are struggling to breathe. And that's true for the nurses, my colleagues, who are watching people's blood oxygen levels go down and down and down. It's true for you, and it's true for me. The pneuma hagion, the Holy Spirit, is as close to us as our own breath. This week, I'd like to encourage you to notice your breath. Is it fast or slow? Can you smell the lilacs blooming? Or the coffee brewing? Can you feel and know that the God who birthed this whole universe into being is abiding with you, inside you, and all around you, even now? This is how breathing can become a spiritual practice, when we pause to notice it, to pay attention. Your breaths will continue, thanks be to God, in and out, whether or not you pause to notice them. But if you do pause and notice them, may you remember the nearness of God, how God is near to you as you join another Zoom call, as you do the laundry for the 7,000th time, as you walk alongside the ocean, as you weigh a lake, awake at 6:13 a.m. for the 49th day in a row, as you grieve the far awayness of so many people you love, as you tend your garden. God is not far from any one of us. Jesus has not left us as orphans. The Holy Spirit, the Advocate, the Comforter, the Breath of Truth, the Pneuma Hagion is coming to us, is with us now, and will not leave us. Thanks be to God. Amen. And now, people of God, will you join me in prayer? Mothering God, we need you to be near us. We are finding ourselves so needy these days, so tired, so short with each other, so heartbroken and so tender. We need your nearness, God. We need you to shelter us under your wings, to quiet us with your song, to hover close. We bring before you the complicated feelings of this Mother's Day, the pain of mothers who have lost children to cancer or violence or estrangement or addiction, and the pain of children who have lost mothers. We bring before you the grief of those who wish they could be mothers but cannot. We bring before you the heartache of those longing to be close to their mothers but cannot in these hard days. We bring to you the tired and overwhelmed mothers with children at home for the 8th week in a row. We bring to you those who wish they had mothers who accepted them, who cared for them, and who nurtured them. And we bring to you our gratitude for all of those who have nurtured us in so many ways. We bring before you the prayer of the first Mother's Day, back before it became a Hallmark holiday, a holiday established by a woman after the death of her mother who cared for soldiers in the Civil War, who worked for peace and public health. And so we pray on this Mother's Day for peace, especially in those communities torn apart by violence, racism, and poverty. We pray for all of those who work for public health, from Dr. Fauci to the janitors and the CNAs. We pray for all of those who continue to meet our needs for food and connection and medical care and safety. Holy One, the needs of this world and this time are too many to name. So hear us as we lift up in the silence our own prayers for our world and for ourselves. Mothering God, you hold all things in your hands. even this broken world, even our breaking hearts, continue to be near us and to make us aware of your nearness now and always. We pray this in the name and in the presence of the risen Christ. Amen.
Hello again. We come to that time in our worship when we have an opportunity to respond to our call as Christians to give of ourselves, our time, our talent, our financial resources. In these challenging days, it's important for those of us who can to continue our financial support of the mission and ministries of Old North Church. On behalf of the Leadership Board and the Prudential Ministries Board, I want to thank you for your contributions in these uncertain times. I also want to share with you some good news about the good work that your gifts are doing. In addition to sustaining the ongoing expense of operating the church, your gifts and offerings are extending our work well beyond our four walls. As you know, April is typically the month that Old North Church fills the shelves of the Marblehead Food Pantry. This year, the pantry volunteers asked us to make financial donations instead of bags of groceries, as we have in the past. You responded so generously. As of this past week, 71 families and individuals from the church have donated a total of $9,655. That is wonderful news. And on behalf of the food pantry, I say thank you for your inspiring generosity. In addition, this past week, the deacons dispersed $2,000 from their discretionary fund to individuals and organizations in need during these challenging times. And of course, all of that is in addition to the benevolent funds distributed by our Outreach Ministries Board. And all of that is the result of your generosity. I encourage you to continue, as you are able, your support of Old North Church and the work Christ calls us to do. Thank you so much. Shall we pray? Generous, ever-giving God, source and spring of all we have and all we are, we pause to give thanks and praise for all your gifts. In these challenging times, may we come to know the true value of what we have received and of what we have to give. May we be gifts to others, just as Jesus Christ is your gift to us. Amen.
people of God, we are tired of this pandemic. If you find yourself struggling with isolation or stress or grief, know that we, your church community, are here for you. Our parish caregivers from the Community Life Ministry Board, led by Linda Hare and Linda Duvel, would love to connect with you for conversation or tangible support with errands. In addition, I'll be leading a group on Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. for those of us dealing with stress and grief in this time, which is all of us. Information on how to connect with Linda and Linda and how to join the Wednesday night group are in the weekly Old North email newsletter. Reach out to office@onchurch.org if you'd like to receive it. And now, receive this benediction. God's peace go with you into the homes in which you live. Be nurtured by this time of gathering. Be faithful in the time apart. Love and serve each other in the name of the faithful God who calls us to be God's people. And the blessing of God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sanctifier be with you always. Go in peace. Thanks be to God. Amen.